missed you last night. We had our volunteers appreciation, and if you haven't volunteered yet, I hope that this year will be a part of that celebration. Talking about volunteers, I remember at church, the pastor, they have this lot appreciation program, and he asked for volunteers in the church to sell Bibles. And so the best salesman came, but there was one who volunteered. He had an impediment in his speech. So he said, "Pastor, I would like to be a volunteer." And so the pastor accepted that volunteer. And after a month, true enough, the best salesman sold thousands of pesos worth of Bibles. But when the one with the impediment, speech impediment came, he sold thrice as many Bibles as the best salesman. And the salesman said, "What's your secret? What is it? How were you able to sell that much Bibles?" "Nothing." He said, no, you have a secret." So he said, "Oh, how did you do it?" He said, "I just told them, the one with the speech impediment, would you like to buy Bibles? Or would you like me to read the Bible?" "Oh, I'll just buy a box of that Bible." So he sold so many Bibles. Okay, we continue with our a series called Going Back to Basics. And we're on the second topic, I Believe in God. Now, I'm sure you've heard of this. If God wants us to believe in Him, why would not God reveal Himself and make Himself visible so that I could talk to Him, I could touch Him, I could see Him with my own two eyes? Or perhaps you've heard, if God would just show Himself now, immediately I would believe in Him. What's so great about faith that God desires it above an obvious revelation of Himself? He could have just written across the sky, "Help." Jacob, that's the proof. If you won't believe in me, you would go to that place. Sign, the Almighty. And you wouldn't have, I'm sure, you wouldn't spend an hour for that guy to really believe that God exists. If God would write something in a huge multicolor pen, "I am God," then I'm sure people would believe, would they? Let me ask you something. Do you really believe 100% in the saying, "To see is to believe"? If I would ask you right now, if you go out and check on the color of the sky, what is the color of the sky? What would you say? Blue. But we know that sky has no color, according to astronauts and astronomers. Or if perhaps you're driving on a hot, sunny day, then you would see shimmering light in front of you. Would you believe that there is a pool of water several meters ahead of you? You call it what? A mirage. A mirage is a refraction of light from the sky because of heated air. So there are other things that exist that we don't see, we don't hear, we don't touch, we don't taste. For example, gravity. We can see it, we can taste it, we can touch it, we can even feel it. But we can feel the effects of gravity. Also, right below your nose, behind your back, even beneath you are invisible waves, air waves. There are actually now, there are characters there, sports celebrities in front of us, invisible. Or you can hear different kinds of music. But does it mean that if you don't see it, if you don't hear it, it would negate or affect the reality of their existence? If God would really come out and say, "Do wonders and signs," what if He really wrote on the sky, "Jesus is my son"? I'm sure, people would believe, "Wow, that's awesome, a great miracle." But you know what happens over time? After a month or a year, the miracle would soon fade. Impression fades. And it happens to even to us. We begin to think that is, was it just a dream or it's the real event in my life. Perhaps my juice was spiked with something, or I ate a moldy ham and cheese sandwich, or a 1 week expired gardenia raisin bread. And then you begin to think and ask people and tell them, and they would say, I think you've lost your mind. And you now start to begin, did it really happen? You know, people who believe in God because of miracles need a steady diet of them. Frequent and more incredible every time. Even though God has the capacity, has the power to give signs and wonders, to produce those miracles, I don't believe that He does it all the time to get His point across. He doesn't need to. So is there any other evidence that points to the existence of God? Yes, if I would ask you, you would say, if I would ask you, do you believe in God? I'm sure you would say yes, because you're here in church. I'm sure, that's obvious. But if someone would ask you, how would you know that God exists? How would you answer them? And that's what we're going to look at this morning. We're going to try and see what God Himself has done to make Himself known, so that we can help also people see the implications of these evidences, that they too would believe that there is a God. And in the end, we would help them that Jesus is God flesh. God flesh, or covered with flesh, and come to trust in Him. Let us pray. Lord, thank You. Would You just move mightily in our midst? And fill us with Your Spirit. Fill this place with Your presence. Empower me. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. I would like you to consider two simple words this morning. God is. God is. That's the central fact of the universe. If you miss that point, you can be right about a lot of many things, but still be wrong in what matters most. And with that in mind, let's think together about these evidences that I would say that I believe in God. First is I believe in God because of the attestation of creation that we see in verses 19 to 20 that we just read. God has made Himself known to every man. That is clearly stated in verses 19 and 20. God has revealed Himself so clearly that no one can miss Him. Even though men try to suppress the truth about God in nature, they can't wipe out, they can completely erase the message because it is plain and easily or clearly seen in nature. Now, this plainly seen revelation of God in nature has been available since the creation of the world, has been available since, in verse 24, since the creation of the world. What does that mean? Adam saw it. Cain saw it. Noah saw it. Abraham saw it. Jacob, Joseph, David, everyone who lived on earth since the beginning of time saw it. I don't want you to miss that point. Everyone knows something about God. No one who has ever lived could miss that point. It doesn't matter whether they consciously thought about it or not. The truth was there for all to see. So plainly laid out that no one would say, I missed it. So it doesn't matter when a person is a headhunter in the jungles of Africa, or a cannibal in the forests of the Amazon, or an upscale yuppie in Makati. No one could miss the truth about God because He clearly revealed Himself as plain as a day. You can see it. The Bible says, the heavens declare the glory of God and the sky proclaim the works of His hands. Now, either you don't see that or not. Brothers and sisters, some people, brilliant scientists, would study the stars for years, for a lifetime, and they would come up and say, there is no God. But there would be other scientists like Hugh Ross, If you want, you can check that cosmic reason to believe. He would say, when he studied the mighty Milky Way, there is a God. Now, Psalm 19 is telling us God has left no room to doubt that He exists. That's the point of Psalm 19. Now, either you see that or no. That's His point. Now, look at verse 2. Day after day, they pour forth speech. Night after night, they display knowledge. The heavens preach a sermon about the wonders of our great God. God so arranged the universe that light from heaven streams in on every side. You have to cover your face so as not to see God. The revelation of God. Psalm 8:3 says, when I consider the heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have set in place, God has left His fingerprints all over the world. Every rock, every tree, every leaf, every fruit, every brook, every river, every ocean, every star in the sky bear the divine DNA that points to a God who created all things. Let me illustrate. Suppose you're going to visit our house in Cavite. How much would you learn about me and my family by just looking around? When you enter the living room, you would know I'm married to a beautiful woman. And I have a handsome son and a beautiful daughter. By just looking at the albums or the pictures in our house. And you would know that the three of them finished the same course. They are all pharmacists if you look at the albums. And you would know that I'm also a veterinarian. When you go around and you look at the veranda, you would know that one of the members of the family is a health buff. Because there is a treadmill, there are dumbbell plates there, there are barbell plates there, sit-up bench. If you go to the computer room, you wouldn't know that I'm a pastor, but you would know that I studied the Bible because Bibles of different versions, of different editions and commentaries are strewn around the computer. And you would also know that someone in the family loves chess because there are chess magazines and chess books and a big chessboard inside the computer room. There are a lot more to discover about the Gonzalez family if you would just rummage around through the drawers and closets. You would know that when you enter the one room that is near the toilet, my son sleeps there and he loves to play drums because there's a drum set inside his room. And when you go to the other room at the middle, you would know that my daughter sleeps there and she's a picayo with many cosmetics and borlolois, everything there. You know? You would know a lot about me even if you don't know me personally. The clues are everywhere for those who care to look. Alright? So that's the point. Brothers and sisters in Christ, the world is God's house. He left clues everywhere about what kind of God He is. The galaxies shout, He is here. The wildflowers in the forest sing, He is here. The brooks join in, He is here. The birds sing it, the lions roar it. The fishes in the ocean write it, He is here. The heavens declare, He is here. The earth repeats it, and the wind whispers it, He is here. All creation joins to sing His praise. Deep cries out to deep, and the mighty trees tell it to the birds that fly overhead. And even, I'm sure, the dogs and cats would agree to this truth, He is here. He is here. No one can miss that message. God has left His fingerprints all over. Truly, this is my Father's world. And every rock, every flower, every mountain bears the signature of God. And He signed His name everywhere. Everything here is marked, made by God. In letters so big and so bold that no one fails to see it. Some people may deny it. But no one fails to see me. Now let's bring that closer to home. I think the greatest physical evidence, visible evidence of God is when you gaze into the mirror. Of course, there are many people who are born with handicaps and impediments, but there are still signs of order and design in that person. Let's begin with the heart. It is not just an organ of evolution. Do you know that it pumps 2,000 gallons of blood a day? You can ask our doctors. You look at the kidneys and lungs. The lungs are not just made up of air sacs. They filter the oxygen that we breathe in. And these organs contain 300 billion tiny blood vessels called capillaries. Your entire blood supply washes through the lungs every day, every minute. Your kidneys filter 1,700 liters of impurities a day. Just imagine the design. The average brain has 100 billion brain cells, far more advanced than any computer system in the world. Your tongue has 8,000 buds. Just imagine if I don't have those buds, I don't enjoy crispy pasta anymore. I'm sure you have experienced being sick and taking a lot of medicines. Everything is bland, tasteless. How boring life would be? Would it be, right? Your eyes have focusing muscles that moves the eye 100,000 times a day. That same eye has a retina, a small retina, that has 100 million light-sensitive cells. You can ask Doc, he's an ophthalmologist. Brothers and sisters in Christ, God even gave us windshield wipers that moves 1:500 of a second. It cannot be manufactured. Yes, you can have an eye operation, an eye transplant, but you will need another person. You can manufacture the eye. The best thing that they can do if you lose your eye is to put a beautiful marble in your socket. No? Even evolutionist Charles Darwin said, to suppose that the eye could have been formed by natural selection seems, I freely confess, absurd in the highest degree. Now just imagine this. If your ears were made inside out, I would have been shouting here for 30 minutes and you couldn't hear me. And just imagine if your nose is made upside down, every time that you take a bath, patay kayo, malulugot kayo, drop, di ba? Or when it rains, when you go, you drown. Or just imagine, you look at the mouth of your neighbor, if he has two tongues, imagine that. There is a visible evidence of a great intelligent designer. Look at the animals. How can a brown cow eat a green grass and produce white milk? And then when that white milk is processed, you make it yellow butter. And when that yellow butter is eaten by man who produces black hair and brown eyes, imagine, watermelon. You grow it with an onion or a garlic. You know, those three varieties would produce their unique taste. But they get the same source of nutrients, the same soil, the same water. Now, you ask our doctors about the acids. There are acids specific for stomach, for intestine, for the reproductive system. How would it go there? But it would run only in one cycle, the Krebs cycle. An intelligent designer is what we have. Creation shows an evidence of a beginner and a designer. In the beginning, God created the heavens. The second one is the conscience. That we see again in verses 19 and 20. There is something about God, a deposit of truth, if you will, which God has made so plain that no one would miss it. When Paul says it is plain to them, it impacts the human conscience. Not only that we see his revelation so clearly, it also impacts the human conscience. Men, listen to this, men know there is a God. Because his conscience, or their conscience, tells them so. They know what is right or wrong. In the second half of verse 20, Paul comments that the truth of God in nature has been clearly seen and being understood from what has been made. Now, those two verbs are very important. Clearly seen, okay? Clearly seen means that everyone has seen something of God's handiwork in the world. Now, understood, it's a much stronger term because it means that the revelation of God in nature strikes the heart of every person. Now, listen to this. This is important. Paul is not suggesting that nature contains the revelation of God so that men may see. That is not a strong statement. Paul is saying that the revelation of God is clearly seen by men, and they eventually understand it to a certain degree. Are you with me? That's what Paul is saying. So nobody here would say, I didn't know that. God, you didn't make that clear. No. Because God completely, alright, He made it abundantly and overwhelmingly clear. That explains why every culture on this earth have a concept or has a concept of a supreme being, no matter how flawed it might be. Man was made to look for answers outside of himself. He has this here looking for a God. So he would try to look at it on every perhaps be money or sex or education or success or approval, all those things. No. That's the point. The French philosopher says, Pascal said, that inside the heart of every man is a God-shaped vacuum. St. Augustine said, Lord, you have made us for yourself. Our hearts are restless until they find rest in you. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 11 says, God has put eternity in our heart. That means that there is that longing for ultimate answers will come from God. God put that longing. God put that eternity. God put that God-shaped vacuum. God put that God consciousness in the hearts of every man so that we would look to Him. That explains, brothers and sisters in Christ, why atheism has never commanded the interest of a wide circle of people. Atheism is the most unnatural philosophy on the face of the earth. Idolatry is more natural. Why? Because the idolater acknowledges that there is a supreme being. There is a higher power outside of himself. Did you get that? And so many others have said it. It takes more faith not to believe in God. So why don't people see the truth about that? There are so many answers that they will give you, but it boils down to this thing. Man is morally and spiritually blind. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4 tells us of the world or the race of man apart from God's grace. The Bible says, the God of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers so that they cannot see the light of the gospel, of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. If you can see, you can see. Here's a vast paradox regarding the human race. As I said a while ago, light from heaven streams on in every side, and you just have to cover your face not to see it. God has made himself plainly clear, plainly known of his truth about himself. Okay? It is clearly seen by every person. All of us know. All of us know the truth about God because of our spiritual DNA, and yet we are blind to know who He really is. That's the point. Thus, most of the human race instinctively believe there is a God. But there is a a minority, a tiny minority that suppresses even the limited knowledge of God. And they call themselves atheists, people who deny God. That is the very definition of what it means to be a fool. You know, 95 years ago, a vast revolution swept across Russia. And that revolution was founded on the view of Karl Marx, that the religion is the opium of the masses. It's a drug. It's a drug that people or fools turn to because they couldn't face life on their own. And the communists for most of the 20th century tried to stamp down the God, no? That there is no God. So they confiscated all Christian literatures. They closed down cathedrals and churches and persecuted pastors and priests. Everything about God. In St. Petersburg, they closed the huge Kazan Cathedral and turned it into the Museum of Religion and Atheism. Three generations grew up in Russia, knowing that there is no God and that religion is just a stain on the face of the earth. But you know what? In the early 90s, people began to go back to God. The true believers didn't give up on their faith. The bedrock of their faith. And you know what happened? Schools opened for the preaching of the gospel. The authorities asked Christians to minister to the hospitals and to the prisons. Bibles were so in demand. I knew that because at the time, I was the president of Gibeon's Cavite City Camp. And we would pray for Russians that they would have the Bibles. Communism has fallen to the ash heap of history. But the gospel of Jesus Christ remains stronger until today. How would you explain such a startling turn of events? I'll give you two facts. One, atheism utterly failed to win the hearts of the people. Atheism is a negation. It is a negative philosophy of life. It doesn't have the power to move the hearts of men. That's why when you are engaged in a debate with an atheist, you ask him, I will debate with you anywhere, anytime. Bring someone who is an addict, a gambler, or a loco that has been changed by the ideology that you embrace. Tell those atheists. Tell me, bring people who have been changed by your ideology. Nobody! But we Christians know, at any time, if there is a Christian there, he can make a testimony that God has changed him. That's the truth about it. And second, there is a hunger for God inside the human heart. When the communists try to satisfy the hunger of people with an empty husk of atheism, people desire more of the bread that comes from heaven. So exactly, what is it about God that is so clearly revealed in nature that no one can miss it? Why are they saying that the Bible is saying that you can't miss the truth about God? And this is very crucial in the argument of Paul because it must apply to everyone who lives on earth. And you know, he gave us two facts. He said, there is an all-powerful God who created the world. That all-powerful God is the supreme being in the universe. Those two statements are the rough approximation of what it means when he says the divine or the invisible qualities of God. In verse 20. His eternal power and his divine nature. His eternal power is evident in the magnitude and grandeur of creation. His divine nature may be seen from the variety and design of the world he made. Do not miss this central point. You don't need the Bible to know that God exists. You don't need the church to figure this out. You don't need even the gospel to know that God exists. Okay? So that means these truths are so plainly seen, revealed even in the man in Timbuktu, where there is no missionary, where there is no Daniel who went there to explain the gospel. So as the Muslim students in the University of Maran, God exists. And He has revealed Himself in creation, in conscience, and most especially, the supreme revelation of God is in Jesus Christ. The universe, nature, the body, all testify to the existence of God, but the greatest evidence was through the life of a famous person, Jesus Christ. Allow me to read to you Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 and 2. In the past, God spoke to our ancestors through the prophets at many times and in various ways, but in these last days, He has spoken to us by His Son, whom He appointed heir of all things, and through whom also He made the universe. If you want an evidence of the existence of God, it is out there. But if you want the clearest evidence, the clearest revelation of who God is, it's in the Bible, especially the life of Jesus Christ. When all is said and done, I believe that our greatest argument, the best argument for the Christian view of God, is in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. God has revealed Himself in the person of Christ. God the Father sent His Son as a tiny baby in this world. And through a miracle, conceived of the Holy Spirit, He was born in Bethlehem. He was born to Joseph and Mary. He was raised in a carpenter's home, misunderstood by His family, rejected by His own people, convicted by the religious leaders to die for blasphemy. But on the third day, God's Son rose from the dead. Ever since the Word became flesh and made His dwelling among us, Jesus has been the great issue between believers and non-believers. The debate no longer centers around scholastic arguments, but it's all about Jesus now. John Piper says, if someone says, why do you believe in God? You can say, I believe in God because Jesus believed in God. And all that I know of Jesus makes me trust Him more than I trust any philosopher, or any scientist, or any theologian, or any friend I ever known or read about. Then you can ask them, do you know anyone more trustworthy or better qualified to teach us about the existence of God than Jesus? And Piper is right. No one is more qualified to teach us than Jesus, to teach us about God. I believe in God because nothing in this universe makes sense without Him. I believe in God because all His fingerprints are everywhere. I believe in God because He revealed Himself through His Son, Jesus Christ. I believe in God because Jesus died and rose again. And I believe in God because He revealed Himself to me, and He gave me eyes to see and faith to believe, and drew me by the power of the Holy Spirit to embrace His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. I believe in God. And that, my friends, it is not that I found God on my own. He drew me to Himself and I gladly came to Him. I believe in God. And allow me to close with this statement. Not only does it make sense to believe in God, it makes no sense not to. No fact is so obvious as the fact that God exists. You have to deny reality to deny the existence of God. The atheist must stand on the ground that God created to deny God. I submit to you, brothers and sisters in Christ, the evidence so overwhelming, creation, conscience, and Christ, but still demands a choice. You still have to make that decision. After all the arguments, after the things that I have presented to you, you have to decide for yourself. Do you really believe in God? And if so, how? would you tell them that really, God really exists? God, I believe in God because nothing in this world makes sense without Him. God exists. He is real. And Jesus Christ is His Son. You believe in God? I hope that when you go out here, if they try, if they ask you, how do you believe? Why do you believe that God exists? Creation, conscience, and Christ. Lord, thank you for your love. I just pray, Lord, that you just move and help each one, Lord, to know you more. Thank you that we can really prove that you exist. That we can really say that you exist. The heavens declare. The skies proclaim. Your handiwork. Our conscience, we know what is right or wrong. You have placed that in our hearts. And most of all, your supreme revelation is Jesus Christ. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. This is our prayer in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you.